Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Pleasure to be here at this wonderful program that has been organized by Entrepreneur, this beautiful magazine. I can see you've all had a very stimulating morning session. The theme of my talk today is on scale-up and profitability of your venture. I was hoping I could see the audience at the back there. I notice you're in complete darkness, so if somebody who's controlling the lights can get more lights into the hall, it's nice to be able to get a little eye contact. But I'll keep speaking while we're at it. Can I, before I do start, that's getting a little better, but if we can get still some more lights at the back, it'll be even better. I want to get a feel of how many people in this audience here are already entrepreneurs. And the second question is, how many of you plan to be entrepreneurs, whether it's the next 5 or 10 years, whatever time, just to get a feel. And I would imagine we'll have a very high response, but let me get a division. So how many of you are already entrepreneurs? Pretty good ratio. And how many of you are planning to become? Okay, so it's like almost a 65-35, two-thirds already there. Wonderful. And for those of you who are already into entrepreneurship, you know, I'm beginning. I would normally, for this sort of a session, I would probably begin at the beginning, and I will end up with the area where I would normally start, and that is where you get your ideas and how you start up. But since the specific theme is on scaling up, I want to just get a feel, how many of you are already at a stage where you believe you've gone past the initial startup, which means maybe the first 2 years or 3 years even, and now you're beginning to really face the challenges of scaling up. So let me get another show of hand. So actually, from whatever I see here, many of you are entrepreneurs. Very few have put up your hands for scaling up. That means most of you are still in the startup stage, where you've got a lot of things to do. So maybe I'll cover some things even on that part as I come towards the end of the session. So now let's get on to the, I won't spend time on the, you know, what I'm planning to cover. Let's move straight into the theme. So the very first thing I do want to say, and I think it's a very important prelude, and I didn't hear all of Kiran's talk, but I know that there was a lot of focus on how technology is changing things, and I heard that coming up even in the question on agriculture. Now, you know, what has happened is that technology has become the enabler of change. And we're in a digital world where almost, I would imagine, a very large part of what all of you all are doing. It's not unlikely that your new ventures, whichever ones you're doing, are things which are driven by changes in technology. And when you consider it's not the technology alone which is important, but it is what you can do with the technology in terms of being able to create new business models, new ways of delivering products and services. If you look at the internet, it took 15 years for the internet to move from internet 1.0, which is a read-only internet, to internet 5.0, which is, you could say, a thinking, semantic, emotional, conversational internet. And all of this is making new and newer business models possible. The other aspect of some of this change is that today, just as the internet has gone through that process, all the new digital technologies are evolving. And they're going to go through as much change as the internet went through in the past. And you can see the change they can bring about. So in the last 4 or 5 years at the time we started Happiest Minds, it was all about smack. But you could see how things then moved on to include things like artificial intelligence, cognitive computing, the Internet of Things is today the biggest area. And of course, there's so many more. I could just name them: virtual reality, augmented reality, nanotechnologies, and so on. But what you do with these is what is helping to create what I'll call is the new world, where you have edutech, fintech, health tech, you name it tech. Every industry is now getting digitalized. So what do you do once you've gone past your startup stage, and I'm moving straight now into scale-up strategy? You know, everybody has what I'd call as an addressable market. And what you have to examine and ask for yourself is, what is the market that I'm able to address? How do I expand that coverage of the market? Now, there are multiple ways of being able to do this. The first thing I must also say is if you're able to continue to grow in one segment and acquire leadership there, there's absolutely nothing like it. Because then you're acquiring an ability to get moving on to profitability much faster, get much better margins, and so on. Good example in our business is Mu Sigma. There's so many startups, but here's this company which has become a unicorn, that is $1 billion market valuation as a private company, and it focuses just on analytics. Now, everybody can't do that. You've got to be able to see how to enlarge your market to be able to get integrated solutions, and that, for example, is the strategy of Happiest Minds. We are not a niche company which says we would only focus on one segment, but the strength in our business is the ability to bring those multiple technologies together. Now, to do this, you can look at moving up a value chain, moving down a value chain, moving into adjacent segments. So there are multiple ways of doing this. At all times, I think you go to balance this challenge of depth versus breadth. And the biggest danger, of course, is to get, you know, almost like what you might call as a mile wide and an inch deep. So you avoid getting overly spread out. You will need partnerships as you move to the next stage. And you know, one thing that you will see as young companies, that those partnerships are typically very important for you to leverage on, but at the same time, they're very asymmetric. And what do I mean by asymmetric? It really means that the other party has a lot more power than you have. And how do you balance that, keeping in mind that you don't want to give away things which you may have a value? You may be looking for a partnership to say, I've developed IP, how do I take that IP forward in order to be able to enlarge a market which I can't do, but the other party might be able to do. I would say that one of the things to remember in such a case is that you never give anybody exclusivity on some of your crown jewels. If you negotiate with a much bigger player, and all of us require them, say for example in our business, we all use Microsoft platforms or an AWS platform, even there you've got to see that you keep a balance in terms of not being restricted by that partner and saying you can't handle something else. So you've got to remember some of those requirements. I think one of the most important parts of in today's day and age, in order to be able to expand your business, is to platformize whatever you can. I'm not sure how many of you have done that. Many people get into new services, etc. Or even think in terms of a product. But if you first consider a platform, and a platform can mean many things to many people, but essentially it is something which helps you to be able to gather data in a way that you're able to then use this in different ways. It may mean being able to create new APIs. It may be different ways of connecting your customers to your suppliers. Perhaps one of the best examples to give is Aadhaar. You know, Nandan could have created Aadhaar as the world's second largest database. Instead, he went out and created it as a platform, and today you can see how many new applications are evolving every day based on the fact that the platform is created. One way I like to think about platforms are, it helps you to make money while you sleep. Literally, the platform then takes over to be able to deliver all the modalities of being able to carry on a business. It's very important that you, in this process of scaling up, don't allow growth to spin out of control. Now, I'm going to, could somebody just get me a glass of water from my bottle of water from there, so I don't stop too. Now, how do you manage to ensure that growth doesn't spin out of control? And I'll give you, in order to do that, it's very important to do what the next line says, and that is to ensure that, thank you so much, your systems, your organizational capability, all of that is scaled up, and of course you move towards profitability, and I'll come to that as a separate item later on. Now the best example I can give, how many of you in your, have ever flown on Deccan Aviation? Many of you probably may not have because you're, I see a few hands. But not that many. If I ask that question in the South, I get a lot more people. But they're the airline which actually invented and created low-cost flying in India, way before Indigo came out and took the market. Now, and it grew at such an exponential rate that things went out of control. Baggage never reached on time. Flights got delayed. I had a common investor with Deccan Aviation, run by Captain Gopinath, a very good friend of mine. And they said, look, we can never get a P&L statement out from them on time. It's about 2 to 3 months later every time. And, you know, maybe they could come over and drop by and hear how you set up your systems. And this was the days I was running Mindtree. Now, we all know what happened with Deccan Aviation. It got finally bought over. And lucky for Captain Gopinath, I often say that he found a bakra in the form of Vijay Mallya. And Vijay Mallya knew nothing about running a low-cost airline, and therefore he's the one who ran into trouble. But the reason for all of this was that they never scaled their systems. Another very important, and I think this will come through in any entrepreneurial decisions, I'm specifically highlighting it here, but timing. When and what is the right time for you to increase your investments for scaling up? And you can't be too early to the market. You should not be too late, obviously, to the market. So how do you get the right time? And it's always a function of judgment, but you've got to keep asking yourself, is this the time for me to be able to put in that money? So I'll come now to a section called is competing against gorillas. And what this really essentially means is that all of us are going to be startups, and Happiest Minds, I still think, is very much so, competing against much larger players in our business. And how do you do it? There are 2 or 3 strategies. Some of these are highlighted in the book which is called Entrepreneurship Simplified, which I've co-authored. And one, which is judo strategy, it was first articulated by C.K. Prahlad and Gary Hamel in a path-breaking seminal article in the Harvard Business Review. Tai Chi thinking is a new metaphor that we've defined. It's based on an experience that we had where when we were engaging a team from Tai Chi, and just to be able to, it's an organization which does training in Tai Chi, and to demonstrate the power, and I think it is there was a young girl, a wisp of a girl, not more than 5 feet, 5 inches in height, and then she invited the largest, strongest looking guy in our office and said, do you think you can push me? And this fellow strained and strained and pushed and pushed and couldn't move her an inch. And then she said, is it okay if I try and push you? And so he said, okay, go ahead. And then literally with what looked like not much more than a flick of a finger, she had this guy staggering back. So we asked later on, well, what is it that was the secret for being able to do it? And that is what we really describe here in the book as Tai Chi thinking. And that is to be rigid where you have to be rigid and flow, like you are like the leaves of a tree which allow the wind to blow through. And I could give you an example how we use this as a strategy in our approach to a huge retailer, one of the largest retailers in the US. We needed to enter the market. We were competing against all the larger players, and they needed to get into an Apple show 3 months downstream. We said, okay, we'll do the job. We're willing to take a penalty clause if we are late on that. But we must also get premium pricing. Their approach was, hey, but you're a small company, so you should give us a low price. And we said, nothing doing. That's the area on which we want to be able to be rigid about. But on other terms, we'll be as flexible as we can be. We deliver the product. The company won an award at the Apple show. They went on to become our largest customer. Guerrilla warfare, as you can well imagine, is just being able to literally look at the opponent's weaknesses, move in, dart out, because they'll be slower to respond as larger players. Coming now to marketing strategies. It's very important that in my view, building a brand begins with a company name. A lot of B2B companies don't give enough thought to it. They become very powerful and large, and therefore it doesn't matter whether it's a TCS or an IBM or whatever. They're not great names. But the names are so large and so well-known, and they've built so much power. But if you look at the B2C companies, they typically have much more innovative names, something which sticks and recollects. On the B2B side, I do love to talk about both Mindtree and Happiest Minds as names which will inspire recollection, stories to be created around them. The best publicity, and this is very important, I heard Kiran talking to you about Google not charging anything. And the same way, the other part is the best publicity is free publicity. This is a very important thing. You're in a digital, data-driven, content-driven business. And what others say about you is far more important than any amount of money that you can spend. It's another important thing about marketing is that it's become very intrusive. How you handle that power is very key. Another very important point, I'd say, in anybody who's seeking out to present offerings to your customers is that excessive choice can confuse your customer and delay decision making. You know, there's a wonderful book by a lady called Sheena Iyengar. She happens to be a professor at University of Columbia. She's written this book called The Art of Choosing. It's not until page 25 that you realize that this lady is blind. Amongst other things, as a hobby, she does interior decoration. Now, how does she do all of that? But her main theory is that, look, when you present too much choice to your customer, you actually confuse them. So you make clear-cut things based on segments and so on, rather than saying you're going to clutter up things with too many things. And then, of course, the most important thing on marketing, be it B2B or B2C, is the fact that you've got to be able to build trust. And the way to be able to do that is really critical in order to get repeat sales. And how you handle the exceptions, I think, is the way you will be able to build trust. I've got a section here on funding your venture. And the reason why that's coming up in a scale-up session is largely because, you know, I believe that money is the fuel for growth, and a lot of people will bootstrap their businesses. And if I can just get a quick show of hands, for those of you who are already entrepreneurs, how many of you have actually been bootstrapping or not even raised, let us say, the equivalent of more than $100,000 as you've started your business? So maybe I could get a little show of hands. Only one person. So then how many of you have actually gone to external investors, whether they're angels or VCs? Okay, so now also there's only one hand. So I'm not sure where the rest of you fit in, because either you've bootstrapped or you've done external funding. Can I take another feel on that profile? How many of you have bootstrapped your business so far? Now you've got a lot more hands. And how many of you have actually raised external money? And I'll exclude family in that. So if you went out to family and went out, and so one or two hands, three, four hands. Now a few more on that also. So it's not too bad. We have about, but it's a very large majority of you have actually bootstrapped. Now, you know, one of the things I see, and I meet at least 25, 30 entrepreneurs with their business plans every year, just as a mentoring exercise. And I find that a lot of them have spent so many years bootstrapping slowly. And you, many of you are very, very young, and you have the luxury of time before you'll build a large business. But at the same time, if you have a good idea, the issue is the size of the pie and not what percentage you own of the company. That's one. Two, a VC does add a lot of value. They provide you, and I'm using VC, I include angels and even private equity for that matter. They bring an ecosystem, they give you ideas, they help you to adapt your original idea, they may even help you with talent. So if you can get that and you can grow maybe 10, 20 times bigger than you would have done had you not raised the cash, it, to my mind, it's a no-brainer if you then choose to have to give away 30% or so of the company for that. While you're raising funds, I think it's very important that you realize how to maximize your value in each round that you do. You've got to remember that every industry goes through cycles of over and undervaluation. I'm not going to get into the details of this at the moment. I do want to keep a little time aside for questions at the end. The next part is that as you scale up, I think the most important thing, which most entrepreneurs will find, you've got hundreds of things to do. You're not going to sit down and take the time and trouble to say that will we articulate a mission, a vision, and the values of the company. So again, if I can get a show of hand, we had about 60% of this group are entrepreneurs already. How many of you have actually articulated your mission, vision, and values? Okay, so not bad, about 10, 12 have done that. Which still means only about, say, 20% of the total number of people who raise their hands to say they're entrepreneurs. And the reason why I think it's very important you do it, factually, you know, very quickly you have to move from the stage of saying I'm the thrill of being an entrepreneur and running an organization. And when you do that, and most companies fail because they don't make that transition, you've got to be clear, the mission defines what you are. The vision is what gives you a shared alignment with goals. And as you get larger, you do need to be able to get everybody aligned to the vision. And then the values determine your behavior, and that then determines your results. So it's important to do this. There will be tough times, there'll be difficult times. When you've articulated these, when you live by these, it keeps the whole organization going together. And it gives you a sense of saying, this is where we are heading. It also defines very importantly the culture that you're trying to create. And in my view, in the end, that can be your most important differentiator. As you proceed, it's very important for you to be able to build your organization. My view personally is that you build the organization you want to be as soon as you can. And again, it goes back to a question of saying, do you have the funds to be able to do it? Now, when we started Happiest Minds, we had three business units, each with its own CEO. We had multiple centers of excellence, multiple practices. We also decided to go global as fast as we could, so we got into 8 countries. Now, all of that needs money. And if you didn't have that, you didn't have the ability. But if we went about it sequentially, frankly, we wouldn't have been even half of the size that we've reached in this period of 5+ years. Another thing I would like to say is that, you know, a founder itself is not a role. It doesn't give anybody a special privilege. I think it's important to be able to remember at all times the distinction between your role as a founder and whatever role you have as a team member, as a part of that team. One thing I would draw people attention to, and I'm sure you struggle through this, the issue of getting talent. And yet there's nothing more difficult or more demanding than or frustrating is when you get a wrong hire. You know, the opportunity cost of that is so large. It's not just the cost of the wrong hire. I can't say that we have a magic wand. It took me 3 attempts before I got a CEO in my Wipro days for the UK market, the right CEO. It took 2 attempts when we did it in Mindtree. All I could say is that luckily, the 3rd time round, we got it right the first time. But again, look at the number of times that you can make errors in this, and each one of those mistakes, depending on the nature of this, can cost you a lot of money. At times, it may be better to just have people multiplexing till you get the right person. Don't rush into the wrong decision. The next part of this is on scaling up and acquisition. Obviously, a part of scaling up is going to be acquisition. And you know, one of the most important things to remember is that most acquisitions fail because of cultural incompatibility. I'm surprised that, you know, in the dot-com boom days, when Mindtree started, I was amazed at the number of companies which did huge acquisitions as soon as they could. So it was other dot-coms providers or companies servicing the dot-com market, merging with others because they wanted to build critical mass. And yet at the same time, there were organizations with distinctly different cultures. And we as a philosophy, for example, said that we won't do any acquisition for the first 5 years. We wanted to have a very clear-cut culture, which would then become so much easier to be able to absorb along with another entity. It's also important to realize that businesses with different rhythms won't succeed. So when you're doing it, you've got to be very clear what are your objectives for the acquisition. Is it to get new skills, to get new customers, new markets, new IP, new domain knowledge? Once those are clear, then you go ahead and take your decision. And whatever you do, I think it should not be an organization which is going to slow down your growth rate. As a startup, you need to expand fast. So whoever's there, they must be operating in a segment which is growing very rapidly. And finally, preferably if you can acquire a profitable company so it doesn't go and add to your cash drain. But having said that, you'd also have to pay more for that entity. And now we'll come to profitability strategies. You know, your first thing I must tell you is that your venture is really only as good as your idea. And I skipped that stage, but it's important for me to come back to it. I think your idea must have a few basic characteristics. It must be solving a specific customer problem. That's a prerequisite. It must be big. It must be scalable so that you could be relevant. And most importantly, it must be differentiated. It is not critical to say that you want to be the first. But when you do come in, you come in with the improved product or service. Now, to give you an example, Google was not the first search engine. Microsoft was not the first operating system. And Facebook was not the first social media platform for that matter. But look at the way they went in, and when they came in with the right idea, with the right differentiators, that they went and captured leadership in their scales. I mentioned to you the importance of funding towards achieving profitability. And then I think it's very important to be able to get a stream of differentiators, including intellectual property, which you develop yourself. I think you've got to be able to, that is what's going to help you get better margins to move to profitability. Another very important point that I want to mention is that price is not a strategy. It's a mug's game. And I'll give you an example here. I think that all the e-commerce players, if they hadn't chosen to make prices their main strategy, they could have built up healthier balance sheets before Amazon, and it was predictable that they would enter the market, before they entered into the market. And today they wouldn't have their backs to the wall. They wouldn't have a situation where probably the only one of the domestic players which would be left will be Flipkart. And even they will face a challenge because, as you know, Paytm, for all practical purposes, is really funded by Alibaba. And Alibaba may come to the fore or may not, but ultimately it will probably end up becoming a two-entity battle between Amazon and them. And finally, just this thought, same thing which I would have told to a Captain Gopinath, or that look, revenue is for ego, but profitability is for a solid, scalable business. And I think it's important for anybody who is aiming to set up a business is to move very quickly towards that path of profitability. And finally, you know, risk minimization. A lot of entrepreneurs get into a macho stage of saying we're risk takers, but that's not. All of us take a risk every day of our lives. In crossing the road, you may take a risk out here. But the job of the entrepreneur is to minimize risk. And the risk of strategic decisions are the ones of errors of omission and commission. The ones of omission are the ones which are the most difficult things. What are the opportunities that you've missed by virtue of being either perhaps conservative or looking in the other direction? I've talked about two early acquisitions. Pivoting strategies, I won't get into this, but that is when you as an entrepreneur decide you have to change your path. And when you do it again, it's very important that you should have enough cash in hand even to be able to manage the pivot. And finally, the final thought, that every strategy is only as good as its execution and implementation. So whatever you do, you've got to be able to see that everything is timed beautifully and well. So thank you very much. And I'd be very happy after this to take any questions that you'd like to have.
Thank you very much indeed, sir, for sharing your insights as well. And we'd also like to inform you all once again that the book authored by him, titled Entrepreneurship Simplified, is available for all of us. It's just outside, so you may grab your copies and they will be signed by Mr. Ashok himself. On that note, we're also going to open the floor for questions. So who has the mic first? May please? Yes, sir. We'll have a question from you and then we'll have the gentleman next.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon. Vivek here from DexLab. So, sir, you were talking about, getting fundings and getting connected with people who have enough money to help us out, not primarily just because of the money, but you also talked about they bringing in industry connects, bringing in ecosystems, and also bringing in a lot of scalability processes that is there with them.
Sure.
Now, my question to you over here is that as an organization that I run, we are into training and development. And we are conducting trainings into newer technologies, niche technologies. Now, if you look at from a traditional perspective, there's nothing innovative about it. But what we are catering to is creating a supply where there's a huge demand. We are just third year into the business. We started with a few lakhs, on track to do a crore right now in terms of revenue. We've expanded from one market to another as well. Yes, we are running a process-intensive organization that we're talking about. But how does a venture such as this goes out to somebody and say that, hey, you know what, this is what I'm doing, and why don't you invest money into me? And we can grow it together, and I can get your connections, and we go to newer markets and places. Because we are not innovating, we aren't doing anything new, we are just addressing our demand.
Yeah, so look, let me try and understand what I've heard from you. You said, look, we really are not an innovative entity. There are multiple others. So how do we go and raise money? That is the essence of what you're saying. And, you know, then you have to go back to the plan. That's fine. You got started. You've been able to deliver some success. It doesn't mean that you're going to raise money in exactly what you're doing. I've also emphasized to you the importance of differentiators. You know, I see so many business plans with people. And I find that I'm not surprised they're not able to raise the money. Then we go through multiple cycles because the plans are really not well thought out. Everybody focuses on numbers, which the VC may or may not believe in any case. They will discount whatever number you give. But they believe in the team for a start. That's something they will invest in. So they really want to see, is this team capable of delivering? It's important to be able to present the right team also to them. But they also want to see that, have you really understood this business and its vagaries and how it will change over a time? So you really need to have a roadmap of your strategies, which is presentable to them, business strategies and marketing strategies. And I think the good VCs that I've dealt with, and actually all of them have been really good on that score, that is exactly what they focus on when you sit down and present your plan. And once you've got it ready, the story becomes easy. You know, there's a flip side to this whole issue. On one side, there's so many entrepreneurs who can't really raise money. But on the other side, there's no country, in my view, which is easier to raise money in today. There's so many. There are about 200 plus angel funds. If you look at the sources of VC funding, in the old days, it used to be the US and maybe the UK. Today, you've got, apart from Indian VCs, you've got US, UK, Japan, China, Middle East funds, so many places, Singapore, all willing to put in money into the country. So there's a lot of money still chasing, I would say, relatively fewer good ideas. Gentleman in the blue.
All right,
there.
Moving on to one last question.
Right, good morning, sir. My name is Govind Goyal. So, based on the same question, I just had a question. That we approached, as a startup, we approached the vice chancellors and per se investors as well. So what they tend to tell us is that the only question they ask us that if we have something authentic or per se innovative. And the second reason they give us not to invest in us is that if we are service providers, for that matter, if we are focusing on service provider or per se an e-commerce website, they will ask us that okay, any other e-commerce based website or personal service provider which is quite renowned and popular in the world right now, if they tackle your idea while you are growing in the market, they would be in a better position to tackle your idea and incorporate amongst themselves itself. So certainly we fail to imply any sorts of our interest towards the market, because the already set up.
I want to make your question a little briefer. I do want to bring one more guy, and I think you're getting into a speech. Just narrow down, what's the question?
Sir, my question is that how can we as a new startup emerge in towards the eye of an investor who thinks that an already set up and popular based startup who is working on e-commerce based website would be incorporating our ideas and would be in a better position to sell what we are trying to sell as an e-commerce based website? That's the only question.
No, so your question is that you got an e-commerce based website and you're saying that it's difficult to raise money in that space as of now. Is that the essence of it?
Sir, no. My idea is to deliver a product, is to provide a service to the users, right? So, per se, a company like Ola or Uber or per se Oyo Rooms, they are into the market very popular. What if they take our idea and expand their business, because they are in a better position to expand their business towards that idea as well? Because we are in the process of making a market, but they have already made a market in that procedure.
You know, I must say, I'm not understanding the essence of what you're saying, to tell you the truth, after your second attempt. All I would is leave you with a few basics. Okay. And because you've even touched upon Ola and Uber, I can give you one thought and idea from there. I've talked to you about differentiation. To my mind, that's key. If whatever you're doing, you've got a differentiated idea, you should be able to get across that differentiation. That's absolutely key. And you could see this in how ABOC company came in much later and then went and developed a successful thing. The second thing you've got to remember about funding is that every cycle goes through cycles of overfunding and overvaluation and undervaluation. There are periods in which they're not going to be interested in it at all. The peak days for e-commerce are clearly over, just like the peak days for IT services went over more than 10 years ago. Happiest Minds is the exception, based on the team we had and based on the track record of two previous successful ventures, that we were able to raise a large amount of money. So you've got to bring factors into this whole thing and say, how do I strengthen and create this picture in order to be able to create that and get money? You talked about Ola and Uber. You know, there's a model which is described in the book called a kaleidoscope model, where you take an existing service and you ask yourself, like in a kaleidoscope, you rotate it. Those are the questions you ask. One of the questions is, how do I change the asset ownership of my business? How do I convert my fixed costs into variable costs? How do I get better asset utilization? Lo and behold, you take one of the oldest services in the world of renting a car, and you end up with an Uber and Ola. The largest companies, car companies in the world, they don't own a single car of their own for, they don't have fixed cost in the sense that all the drivers are self-employed entrepreneurs. And of course, they, those same people ensure the best asset utilization. So you do have to think laterally to get your differentiators. I must take the gentleman there in the blue shirt who had put up his hand first.
Yes, sir. Really enjoyed your talk, sir. I have this question. I was going through a course by a professor from London School of Business. And there, that professor mentions that even without taking a venture capital or external funding, you can grow up a business to a big scale. So how much practically feasible this is? This is my question one. And sir, my second question also, like if suppose a startup is at ideation phase, how to catch the attention of venture capitalists if you are looking for a bigger funding? If that is, and the entrepreneur is really confident about the future of the business and how it is going to work and its innovative idea.
Sure. So, you know, your first one where you've quoted a professor at the London School of Business, and that's fair. There will be multiple points of view. One thing I will tell you that, of course, when I say that the largest, most successful entities, and it depends on the size and scale and your own ambition, typically they've all grown by using external funding. It is not to say that they're not people who've not become large, without taking that amount of, you know, without taking money and so on. Of course they are. But they're almost the exceptions to prove the rule. If you think of, let's say, 1,000 organizations which have really grown to become large, successful organizations, gone public, then you will find those who didn't raise external money and continue to bootstrap, they won't even be 50, if you ask me, out of the 1,000. So that's the scale. Now you can continue. You're young enough to say, I've got the time in order to be able to grow. But on the other hand, you could also say I'm young enough, like if you look at the Google guys or you look at Facebook, all of them, they were also pretty young entrepreneurs, but they saw the value in taking the money and scaling up. So I would say that's, it's a mindset, it's an approach of saying what are your scale, size, and ambitions. Your second question, in a manner of speaking, is what I've been really talking about here. If you have your differentiators clear, if you've got your team put up clearly, you've got a roadmap ahead of how you're going to face possible challenges. You've indicated to them that you understand the risks in the business. All of that is clear. I think you should be able to raise your funds. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Well, I'm so sorry, sir, due to paucity of time, you won't be able to accommodate another question. My apologies. But I'm going to request you to please connect with our sir, Mr. Ashok, offline as well. Thank you for that. We're going to march ahead. I'm going to request Ms. Ritu Maria to please come on stage to present a token of gratitude to our speaker, Mr. Ashok Soota, for a wonderful session there. I'm going to remind you all that his book, Entrepreneurship Simplified, is available for all of us to pick as well, but you can do so while he signs the copies, so you may do so during the breaks as well. Let's have a huge round of cheer one more time, ladies and gentlemen.